Paris, left bank, the Latin Quarter, the heart of the capital's intellectual life. Place de la Sorbonne, the Sorbonne Chapel. Two banners on the facade of the chapel invite us to visit an exhibition on the life and work of Ostad Elahi. This exhibition was inaugurated on September the 5th, 1995, as part of the centenary celebrations of the birth of Ostad Elahi. There was also a symposium at the Sorbonne from September the 7th to September the 10th, 1995, entitled Spirituality, Plurality and Unity. Both events were sponsored by several national and international institutions. Who is Ostad Elahi? Philosopher, eminent judge, musician. Articles in the press have awakened our curiosity. We are moved to find out who this exceptional person was. The first panel tells us that the exhibition is divided into three main sections entitled Dawn, Sunrise, and Full Sun, corresponding to the three major periods of Ostad Elahi's life. A special section is devoted entirely to his music, which occupies a very important place in his life and work. Some parallels between important moments in the life of Ostad Elahi and a number of historic events serve to place him in the context of his times. This exhibition is a simple homage that cannot fully render an account of the many facets of Ostad Elahi's personality. It is intended, more than anything, to evoke his exceptional personality with the help of some personal objects, a number of biographical records, extracts from his music, and some of his words of wisdom. In each section, a short film provides a brief account of the main events of that particular period in the life of Ostad Elahi. This could be considered as a prelude to the exploration that lies ahead.
The Creator, the Spiritual, the universe, man and his destiny. Ostad Elahi devoted the whole of his life to these questions. He would teach that in mysticism, the heart of the matter is to realize why we have been brought into existence, what our duties are, and what our ultimate goal is.
Thank you.
invited to cover the various stages of the life of Ostad Elahi is to be called upon to embark on an essentially interior journey in which the commonplace stands side by side with the exceptional.
Let us leave these impressive landscapes and move on towards Dawn, the section dealing with Ostad Elahi's childhood and youth. The genealogy of Ostad Elahi has been traced back to the 14th century. Existing documents give an indication of the great respect all his ancestors inspired as a result of their courage and the nobility of their disposition. Ostad Elahi's father, Haji Nimat, a landowner and a dignitary in his region, was especially well known as a learned man, a great mystic, and a poet. Ostad Elahi was born on September the 11th, 1895, in Jehunabad, a Kurdish village in western Iran. Under the guidance of his father, at the age of 9, he began a cycle of ascetic practices that lasted for 12 years. Three central showcases contain objects that are reminiscent of the atmosphere prevalent in his childhood. Here, a few traditional dervish tools. The word dervish, in its true sense, means one who has triumphed over his desires. The axe was originally used as a weapon, but in the hands of a dervish, it eventually became a symbol of the inner struggle against the imperious self. The hollow inside the begging bowl symbolizes the inner purification and the abandonment of all selfishness necessary to become receptive to the divine will. Some finely engraved objects of great value. Another traditional dervish accessory, the cap, is covered by some fine material embroidered by the hands of the dervish who wore it.
Old-time dervishes were truly detached from the material world. They kept their hands busy all the time so that their mind would not wander. They set themselves a program of needlework or some other handicraft. Their hands did the needlework and the mind was focused on the divine.
On this wall, images from the native village and the family house of Ostad Elahi.
My father used to say to me, "It is as if I have raised you in a fine garden. If you look beyond the garden walls, you will see nothing but baseness and impurity." When I entered society, I couldn't imagine that it was possible for people to lie or cheat or do anything immoral. On account of this, I suffered a great deal.
In the central showcase of the section Dawn, there are some indications of the teachings Ostad Elahi received from his father. The large manuscript, dictated by his father, Haji Nimat, is in Ostad Elahi's own hand. A long poem of about 15,000 verses, entitled The Book of the Kings of Truth. It was published for the first time in 1966 by the Institute of Franco-Iranian Studies, headed by the late Professor Henry Corbin. Another manuscript contains 2,000 verses composed by Ostad Elahi in his youth. In it, there are expressions of mystic experiences, intimate conversations with the Divine Beloved, and words of guidance. The small notebook is a collection of prayers in the form of 1,500 verses written by Haji Nimat. As a child, every Thursday night, Ostad Elahi would recite all these prayers before going to sleep. The practice of the art of Persian calligraphy was a source of pleasure to Ostad Elahi. Despite its complex technique, this sophisticated practice requires only a few simple tools. In the third showcase, a few objects belonging to Ostad Elahi. Among them, a cane with a finely engraved silver handle. A jasper necklace that belonged to his mother. A special item, a riding whip, reminds us that Ostad Elahi was an excellent horseman. The first photographs of Ostad Elahi were taken when he was 26 years old.
The photograph in which I have long hair and wear a turban goes back to the time when I had just turned 26. How marvelous it was. I was in an angelic world and lived in a state of constant asceticism, eating only one meal a day just after sunset. Even so, I had a fresh and rosy complexion and felt fit and well all the time.
In accordance with a mystic tradition of the times, his hair had not been cut since the age of 6. Yet at the age of 34, Ostad Elahi decided to cut his long hair, thereby symbolizing the end of an era and the beginning of a new spiritual cycle. In 1920, shortly after his marriage and the birth of his first son, the passing of his father marked the end of the period he later called the happiest years of my life. We are now coming to the end of the section, Dawn. A short film brings this section to an end.
Not far from the city of Kermanshah in western Iran lies the Kurdish village of Jehunabad. A 10-mile-long byroad connects Jehunabad to the main provincial highway. Not far from this junction lies Mount Bisotun, bearing on its stony flanks cuneiform inscriptions 2,500 years old, attesting to the trials and triumphs of the Achaemenian king Darius the Great. Jehunabad is a typical Iranian village with straw and clay-covered roofs and walls, and some trees here and there, breaking the monotony of mud-colored constructions. Notwithstanding its humble appearance, Jehunabad, in the past 150 years, has been a lively center of the age-old Persian mysticism. All along these years, it has been the seat of some saints, surrounded by their families, who have loyally followed their spiritual paths. One of those families is that of the ancestors of Ostad Elahi. My father Haji Nimat was an author and a mystic poet and was considered by many as a great saint. While very strict in his ways, he was in essence most compassionate. I never knew anyone whose faith would be equal to his. My mother, Sakina Khanum, was a woman of great virtue, completely devoted to my father, who used to say that he owed her the greater part of his success. It was in this house in Jehunabad that I was born on the 11th of September, 1895. Our house was convenient in every respect. Its different rooms gave onto the inner courtyard. It was within these walls, far from the noise and agitation of the world, that I spent my childhood and adolescence. My father gave a good deal of attention to my moral education and my musical formation. I remember that one day, when he had reprimanded me for some reason, an old woman who worked in our house said to me, "My dear, what have you done that your father..." But I snubbed her before she had finished. She didn't say anything. A few moments later, my father said to me, "If I forgive you for the first mistake, I won't do it for the second one, which was that you broke the heart of that old woman. You must first obtain her pardon." He was very exacting when it came to the question of respect for others. From the age of 9, under my father's watchful direction, along with some of his companions, I started a life of ascetic retirement within the confines of our house. This life was to go on for 12 years, punctuated by interruptions of 10 to 15 days between the periods of 40-day fastings. Most of my time was given to music and prayer as well as studies. These years, filled with inner experiences, during which I was steeped in spirituality, were the most beautiful years of my life. When I was 24, my father passed from this world. I was greatly distressed because in addition to his being my father and my guide, we were united by a very special spiritual bond. A new page was turned in my life.
After dawn, sunrise. This section deals with Ostad Elahi's professional life and his activities within society. Some time after the passing of his father, Ostad Elahi took up residence in different cities in Iran, while continuing to pursue his spiritual researches. He had come to the conclusion that the time for secluded contemplation and ascetic practices had come to an end, thus demonstrating that from then on, spiritual progress no longer depended on renouncing the world, but rather on leading an active life in society, the subject detailed on this panel. Several photographs sum up the course of Ostad Elahi's professional life, first as an employee at the registry office, and then as a magistrate. His diploma from the National School of Jurisprudence.
No matter what work one undertakes to do, one should do it with utmost seriousness and not be negligent about it, so that one may carry it out in the best possible manner. I was so serious in carrying through my studies that I succeeded in passing within 6 months a judicial course that had been designed to take 3 years.
The sayings on the wall are among the reflections made by Ostad Elahi on the position of a magistrate.
Before entering public service, I was unaware that my 12 years of ascetic practice and prayer had no more value than a single year spent in society. The judicial tasks and delicate missions to which I was assigned contained such lessons that I could not have received under any other circumstances.
He often gave his rings and rosaries as gifts to people around him. In this showcase, a few rosaries as well as some rings studded with pieces of agate and turquoise. To each of these objects, Ostad Elahi assigned special functions. Each ring or rosary was reserved for a particular prayer. Some of these rings date back to the 17th century. The fine engravings gives them great value. Ostad Elahi had a very strong sense of justice, which was not limited to the confines of his professional obligations. For him, the humblest object, the merest incident in daily life, deserved to be considered in the light of universal order and harmony. This showcase contains a number of simple personal objects, including an old lighter that has deserved to be talked about at length.
The story of this lighter goes back to when I was the public prosecutor in Rome. One day, when I was on leave, someone I had encountered on the street tried to hand over to me a file about a case he wanted me to handle. Since it was professionally inappropriate for me to be in direct contact with a plaintiff, I stressed the fact that every petition should be filed only during office hours and in accordance with regular procedures. Had it been a case of some public interest, I would have accepted the file without hesitation. But it was all about a personal problem which wasn't at all urgent. I asked the plaintiff to present his file to the court next day, but he insisted so much that I had to repeat to him, rather dryly, what I had told him already. Back at home, while looking around for something, I came across a lighter which I hadn't used for a very long time. When I tried to make it work, some petrol leaked out, spreading over my hand without my noticing, and when I lit the lighter, my hand caught fire and was badly burnt. That same night, I was told in a dream, "You must thank God that your hand hasn't been cut off. Your mission is to attend to people's problems, and look how you make a distinction between a holiday and a work day, just as your colleagues do. You made that person unhappy and he left with a heavy heart. You're fortunate you didn't do it purposely."
Other objects and documents belonging to this period of Ostad Elahi's life. A few deeds of family properties here. And here, some personal objects, including a chess box. And some letters written in his hand. Of the 27 years of his judicial career, Ostad Elahi was called upon to travel to different parts of the country, to take on different assignments. The chronology of his career and the cities he was assigned to are all indicated on this map of Iran. On the platform, a small writing table. And to the right, the judge's robe and some personal accessories. Ostad Elahi considered his judicial tenure as an opportunity to test his ethical principles. He was the very example of professional conscientiousness. His firmness and courage in the face of financial and political pressures were unshakable, as bear witness the official files in the ministry archives. His impartiality went hand in hand with a compassion and a sense of humanity that made him particularly attentive to those ignored by society, the truly helpless, and orphans cheated by their legal guardians. Another display of professional and personal documents. Some pages from the official files of Ostad Elahi and a few observations and comments he addressed to the Minister of Justice regarding certain decrees published in the Judicial Bulletin. In the attaché case, some notebooks containing personal observations, practical remarks, translations, and poems. Some photographs from the time of his tenure as a judge bring us to the end of the section devoted to his professional life. Each year on his birthday, September the 11th, Ostad Elahi had his photograph taken. The photos here represent the years 1952, 1955 and 1957. Again, a short film summarizes this period of his life, putting an end to the second section.
After the passing of my father, while continuing with my ascetic practice, I decided to leave the seclusion in which I had always lived. For several years, I stayed alternately in my native village, in Tehran, and in Kermanshah, attending at the same time to the administration of my land, the practice of music, and my spiritual researches. Little by little, I came to feel that a radically new approach to mysticism was needed, and I began to explore new paths that would make it possible for human beings to attain perfection. Even though the basic principles of a spirituality are immutable, the modalities of their application vary with time. The time for ecstasy and solitary meditation had come to an end. After some years of research, it became clear to me that the best way for testing my ethical principles and broadening my vision was to be in touch with society. That was why in 1929, I cut my long hair exchanged my traditional robes with a modern suit of clothes, and took a job at the registry office in Kermanshah. 2 years later, I became a civil servant at the registry office of Tavjirish in the north of Tehran. At the same time, I had my name registered at the Superior School of Jurisprudence. No more than 6 months was left before the end of the three-year course of studies, yet I succeeded in passing the final examination. Thus, I embarked on a judicial career that took me through numerous judicial responsibilities in different parts of the country until the year 1957. Throughout all these years, I went on with my spiritual researches, trying to make use of my experiences in order to further enlarge my vision. I was personally reluctant to enter public service, but God decided otherwise. He somehow forced me to become a judge and gave me sensitive assignments. Later on, I realized that each of those assignments contained innumerable pearls of wisdom that thousands of sages and philosophers together could not bring forth. As a judge, I would do things that no one dared to do. I would have preferred to be dismissed rather than giving an unjust verdict. That was because I was accountable only to God and not to the ministry. And I wasn't afraid of anyone. My 12 years of devotional and ascetic practice had no more value than 1 year in the midst of society. That is why I recommend you to live in society and at the same time assume a dignified and exemplary behavior.
We now enter the section called Full Sun, presenting the last period of Ostad Elahi's life. This section is based on the theme of closeness and harmony. Harmony in his daily life, closeness within his family, and harmony in his thought, as revealed by objects and photographs on display. It is modeled after the shape of his mausoleum. Retiring in 1957, after a long judicial career, Ostad Elahi settled in Tehran for good. From then on, he was able to concentrate fully on his spiritual research and writings. With exemplary simplicity, he would receive at his house people from all walks of life, seeking answers to their questions. A few photographs evoking his family life.
Families given to mutual respect and affection would never fall apart. They would live instead in joy and prosperity all the time. O God, do not take away from us the union and the affection with which we are blessed. Thank you.
on display in the first showcase are some manuscripts of the works of Ostad Elahi. The published works include Proof of the Truth, first published in 1962. Commentary on the Book of the Kings of Truth, published as a supplement to the 1984 edition of the Book of the Kings of Truth. And the Inner Knowledge of the Soul. The unpublished works include Truth of Parables, written at the age of 28. In the second showcase, among notebooks of poetry and calligraphy, there is a leather-bound manuscript. This is a collection of sacred texts in Kurdish verse, entitled Kalami Saranjam, dating back to the 14th century. There are three authenticated transcripts of Kalami Saranjam, dating back to the 19th century, this small manuscript being one of them. As the sole authority on such texts and their contents, Ostad Elahi was able to distinguish between the authentic manuscripts and the falsified versions circulating over many centuries. This enabled him to compile a complete and accurate version of these sacred texts. Some examples of Ostad Elahi's calligraphic exercises. The technique of calligraphy is intimately related to the transcription of sacred texts and poetry. Calligraphic exercises on wrapping paper. In one of the two showcases here, a traditional robe as homewear, and in the other, an everyday suit. Watches belonging to Ostad Elahi, each from a different period of his life, testify to the importance he gave to discipline and precision. The cord on this pocket watch was woven by the hands of Ostad Elahi himself. He often gave watches as presents to his family members and friends. He also kept very precise accounts of his transactions. He was extremely careful not to forget any debt he might have with anyone. His accounting books served as reminders in this respect. A model of clarity and simplicity, Ostad Elahi's last will and testament made it possible for his family to settle his affairs after he passed away without encountering the slightest difficulty or causing any inconvenience to anyone. Here is a deed of endowment. Down below, the manuscript of the supplement to the book Proof of the Truth. Even in his advanced years, Ostad Elahi was in excellent health. One day, someone asked him about the secret of his good health.
I never had any addiction whatsoever. And what's more, life's troubles never affected me. Every morning I do some Swedish exercises that work all parts of my body. And to prevent this from being boring, I have composed a prayer for each movement. I also practice some traditional fitness exercises that include, amongst other things, press-ups and exercises with heavy wooden clubs.
On this envelope, a drawing by Ostad Elahi. He once said,
I could only draw three things, two roosters fighting, a nightingale in a cage, and a fish in a pond.
On this wall, some sayings by Ostad Elahi.
A true human being rejoices in the happiness of others and sympathizes with them in their sorrow. To find God, we must penetrate our inner self and look into our own heart. Thus one can see that God is everywhere and there is none but Him.
Ostad Elahi departed from this world in 1974. On his tomb, a mausoleum was erected in his memory. In 1981, some misguided individuals bent on discrediting his teachings decided to tear down his shrine and desecrate his body. When the tomb was destroyed, they found it empty. This photograph represents the reconstructed mausoleum. As in the other two sections, a short film retraces the events of the last period of Ostad Elahi's life.
From 1957, the year of his retirement from a distinguished judicial career, Ostad Elahi settled in Tehran for good. Meanwhile, he was able to spend more time with his family. He gave full attention to researches that resulted in the publication of his major works and the completion of his musical repertoire. His first book, Burhan al-Haq, Proof of the Truth, published first in 1962, presents for the first time an authoritative assessment of the sacred text of the Order of Al-Haq, the devotees of truth. The purpose of this book is to explain the various stages of religion and defend above all the esoteric or internal dimension of all religions. Some years later, he published Ma'rifatul Ruh, Inner Knowledge of the Soul, charting the different stages that the soul must cover in order to attain perfection. At the same time, Ostad Elahi began to expound his teachings, which were the fruit of a lifetime of reflection and experience, and to present his thought to those who looked for them. Without expecting anything in return, and with great simplicity, he welcomed at his house people from all walks of life. Attracted by his wisdom and his music, they came to seek an answer to their questions. Ostad Elahi has provided a rational and coherent definition for spirituality. His teachings are practical and are formulated in simple terms. His thought and method, called by himself the path of perfection, are accessible to all. A short while before his passing, Ostad Elahi had said, "I have no last wishes except that I be buried in a corner. I haven't the slightest attachment to this world, and I'm ready to answer the call of God." He passed away from this world on the 19th of October, 1974. A mausoleum has been constructed at the site of his tomb.
Incorporating the results of his experiences in a coherent and rational system of thought called the Path of Perfection, Ostad Elahi has given a new definition to spirituality that is better suited to the demands of our times. He has demonstrated that spirituality is an experimental science, with its own proper axioms, laws, and precise principles that can be expressed in simple language. Through the practice and application of the laws governing the process of perfection, we become conscious of our inner self, Thus, we become totally aware of true selfhood, and then discover where we have come from and where we are going. A multimedia presentation makes it possible for the visitor to become better acquainted with the life and work of Ostad Elahi. Reading cards containing extracts from the teachings of Ostad Elahi also present us with various aspects of his thought. We now enter the area dedicated to Ostad Elahi's music. Here, for the first time in public, everyone can sit down and listen to Ostad Elahi's music, which is played continuously in this room. From early childhood, Ostad Elahi showed an exceptional musical talent. His father initiated him, at a very early age, to the art of the tanbur, a traditional lute, the choice instrument of a sacred tradition. As a child prodigy, he attracted the attention of musicians from different regions, invited by his father to teach him their art. His aptitude for music was such that at the age of six, his playing and his knowledge of the tanbur already generated admiration. At the age of nine, he was an undisputed master of the tanbur. The tanbur has an egg-shaped sound box and a wooden neck fitted usually with two strings. By adding a third sharp string, Ostad Elahi greatly expanded the technical possibilities of the instrument. Moreover, he revolutionized the technique of playing the tanbur by making use of all the fingers of both hands. Later, he studied the classical repertoire of Persian music and learned how to play the tar, the setar, the reed flute, the daf, the kamunche, and the violin.
If put at the service of spirituality, music will connect us to the divine. Pity it's been turned into a vehicle solely for material enjoyment.
Ostad Elahi never played outside the circle of his close friends and family. Nevertheless, some renowned musicians had the opportunity of listening to his music.
L'impression est venue parce que ce merveilleux musicien a pu garder une tension, une concentration que je n'aurais pas jamais pu imaginer être sorti de la dimension petite d'une carte, d'une quinte, et de pouvoir absolument tenir cet intérêt musical dans le cadre d'un intervalle si restreint, me paraissait une chose extraordinaire. Je n'avais jamais entendu, c'est l'impression la plus grande que j'ai eue, et une musique très, très sensible, très intense, mais aussi très précise et très pure. Je ne pouvais presque pas croire à mes oreilles.
Maître Elahi était lui-même un musicien extraordinaire. Il a joué de la musique, après j'ai dansé sur cette musique, mais je ne peux pas dire avec des mots ce que j'ai vécu, ressenti. Ce qui est que ça a été quand même un très grand changement dans ma vie, dans mon existence et dans ma pensée.
Ostad Elahi's personality and teachings have inspired a number of contemporary artists, some of whom are presented here. Several books and objects specially prepared for the occasion of Ostad Elahi's centenary are available at the bookshop. At the end, the visitor's book is at everyone's disposal, should they wish to sign it or put down their impressions. At the end of this exhibition, the best phrase that comes to mind is a saying by Ostad Elahi himself.
I take pleasure when I see that those who come to my house are pleased and happy when they leave.